Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is March 5th, 2017. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Good morning.
Good morning,
and welcome to our worship service this morning. Give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Clark County area, or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John your new church home. This morning, our entire service, except for the hymns, is in your bulletin. So we ask that you please turn to page 2 in your bulletin, and I invite those who can do so without difficulty to stand as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a co-ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by the Lord, I therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We now begin our worship with the glory of these 40 days, hymn number 320, in the back of the red hymnal in your
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church. This hymn, The Glory of These 40 Days, was 11th century Latin hymn, very old. The Christian Church has been observing Lent for many, many years. This is 11th century, written by Maurice F. Bell, Latin hymn, 11th century. Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church. This is the first Sunday of Lent, March the 5th, 2017, Pillars of Lent, prayer, fasting, and almsgiving.
Thank you. now pray together the prayer today as it is printed at the top of the today's reading insert in your book. Let us pray. Lord God, our strength, the struggle between good and evil rages within and around us, and the devil and all forces that defy you tempt us with empty promises. Keep us steadfast in your word, and when we fall, raise us again and restore us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God.
Connie Singleton will be doing the readings.
Good morning. The first reading is from Genesis, 2nd and 3rd chapters. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God say you shall not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die." But the serpent said to the woman, "You will not die, for God knows that when you eat it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were open, and they knew that they were naked. And they were sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Dimitroff will be doing the psalm.
Well, I hope my tongue, my bones will.
second reading is from Romans 5th chapter. Just as sin came into the world through one man, and death came through sin, so death spread to all because all have sinned. Sin was indeed in the world before the law, but sin is not reckoned when there is no law. Yet death exercised dominion from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sins were not like the transgression of Adam, who is a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died through the one man's trespass, much more surely have the grace of God and the free gift and the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for the many. And the free gift is not like the effect of the one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brings justification. If, because of the one man's trespass, death exercised dominion through that one, much more surely will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness exercise dominion in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as one man's trespass had to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. For just as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Time now for our Lenten acclamation leading up to the gospel being read by our pastor, Pastor John Pollock, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. And this theme today is the temptation of Jesus in the wilderness.
He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again the devil took him to a very high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and all their splendor, and he said to him, "All these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan. It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. First of all, as many of you may have heard, we lost our sister Pauline from the Church Militant to the Church Triumphant Friday afternoon after several years of struggling with Alzheimer's. Her visitation will be this Friday, March 10th from 12 to 1 at Littleton and Root, and the funeral service will be at 1 o'clock Friday at Littleton and Root. So please remember Barney and Tammy and Steve and all the family as we mourn the passing of Pauline from the Church Militant to the Church Triumphant. Also a reminder, this Wednesday there will be an afternoon service at 2 o'clock at the chapel. If you come to the 2 o'clock service, I ask that you come through the Wittenberg entrance so that we might have to try and keep track of both entrances for the worship service. So again, 2 o'clock will be in the chapel. At 5 o'clock, we will have our first Lenten supper for this Lenten season. The council will be providing the food. And at 6:30, then worship service here in the sanctuary. Our topic this week, as we look at important words of our faith, this week is the Word. What do we mean by the Word? And the last announcement, be sure when you go to bed next Saturday that you spring your clocks ahead an hour. This is the worst night of the year when we lose that hour of sleep and have to jump our clocks ahead. So if you don't change your clock next week, this would be 12 o'clock now almost instead of 11. So please remember to move your clocks up. Ask now that you give your attention to it.
Thank you.
us for today with Shadow Showdown in the Desert. And M trying to sit on the chair today. Person brought it by and stated, so would you feel more comfortable sitting in the chair with your leg bothering you so much? And I said, sure, well, I tried it yesterday. Of course, I had slacks and a polo shirt on, and I said it really easy. Well, 8 o'clock, I tried again with all these vestments on, and I'm like this. And I'm sitting, got a chair with a collar on my one hip, and trying to go like this because the arms are caught on the other hip. But that's not so easy to get in a high chair when you got vestments on. But I made it, so moving. So, showdown in the desert. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Most of us, as I look at the crowd this morning, will remember the golden days of TV and the movies when a lot of TV programs and a lot of movies were westerns. And one of the highlights, especially of the TV westerns, and also many movies, was the showdown in the middle of the town street between the sheriff and the bad guy, or between the quick draw artist and the young upcomer who wanted to prove that they were as fast as the legend was. And so we would watch as that would come to a climax and one person would outdraw the other. Well, this morning in our gospel lesson, we read about a showdown in the desert. And it's not between a quick draw artist and an upcomer. It's not between a sheriff and an outlaw. But it is a showdown between Jesus Christ and Satan. And in this showdown between Jesus and Satan, we learn some important lessons on how we can resist and defeat Satan in our own lives. And what we learn from this showdown can be an important lesson for us each and every day of our life as we continue to fulfill our earthly pilgrimage. So as we go back to our gospel lesson this morning, Jesus had been baptized in the River Jordan. The heavens had opened, a dove had descended. God's voice was heard to say, "This is my son, the beloved, with whom I am well pleased." Oh, this wonderful happening. And then, instead of there being a big celebration, the Spirit drives Jesus out into the desert. For 40 days and 40 nights, Jesus fasts and prays. And as the gospel lesson told us, he was famished. He was hungry. And who pops up but Satan? Satan comes to challenge Jesus and to try and overthrow God's plan of salvation. So, from this contest, the first step we learn in how to resist the devil in our own lives is that we must know our opponent. That Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Just as we are tempted every day by the devil. That word tempted means to be enticed to do so. It means to solicit you to engage in some improper behavior. It means to provoke you to sin. So this is what the devil was trying to do with Jesus. He was trying to provoke him to sin. To have him violate God's plan of salvation so the devil could once again be victorious, as he had been so many centuries before in the Garden of Eden when he were in God's creation tempting Adam and Eve and their falling into his temptation. So we must know our opponent. He is Satan. Satan, the Bible tells us, is a fallen angel. He led a rebellion against God in heaven and had angels back him. They were defeated. And as Jesus tells us, he saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven to the earth. Now church tradition tells us, or surmises, that Satan was an archangel. That possibly Satan had the supreme archangel title, that which is given to Saint Michael today. And church tradition says that it was Saint Michael who led the loyal angels, Satan the archangel led the rebellious angels. If we fall, Saint Michael wins, the good angels win, Satan's cast out of heaven. He's the leader of that rebellion, and so that is who our opponent is. He also is known by a lot of names, not just Satan, the devil, everyone, Diablo, all kinds of names. But there are also very simple names, like the father of lies. Because Satan's a liar. That's all Satan does is lie. He comes to us and he presents us with a situation and tells us, oh, it's going to be wonderful, we enjoy it, we should do this, but he doesn't tell us the back end of the situation. The part that's going to bite us. The part that's going to bring about destruction. The part that's going to bring about tears and torment. He just tells us the phony part. So he's the father of lies. He is the deceiver. He deceives us with his actions. He deceives us by telling us, oh, he's really our friend. That he just wants to help us alone. That he wants to make life easier for us and enable us to enjoy life more. So he uses deception to confuse our thinking. He's a slanderer. He slanders God. He slanders Jesus. He slanders the church. And he slanders us. Slanders us before other Christians. Slanders us before Jesus. Slanders us so that hopefully we will fall away from our Christian faith. And the last thing about him is he is the accuser. He accuses us before God. He tells God that we are not worthy of Jesus' death upon the cross. That we're not worthy to be washed in the blood of the Lamb. That we're not worthy to be saved by grace through faith because we're just far too terrible of a person. Remember the book of Job, the very first chapter. It opens by telling us about Job and how wealthy Job is and how wonderful a life he has. And then suddenly the scene switches to heaven. And God has called all of his court together. And in comes old Satan. And God says, Satan, what have you been up to? And he says, oh, I've been going up and down and to and fro upon the earth. And God says, well, have you noticed my wonderful servant, Job? And this is where Satan accuses Job. He says, yes, Lord, I've seen Job, but he only follows you because you blessed him so much. He's only following you because you just let everything he touched turn into success. He's got a big, wonderful family. He's got all kinds of cattle. He's got all kinds of wealth, wonderful pastures, hard crops that harvest. So that's the only reason he's following you. So he is accusing Job of having a false faith. But God knows better. He knows that Job is truly faithful. And that's what he does to us. He accuses us before God. That person is too terrible, God. You don't even want him in your kingdom. But God stands up for us through our Lord Jesus Christ. Another thing the devil does is he tries to sow doubt in our minds. Remember our first lesson, Adam and Eve in the garden. He comes up to Eve in the form of the serpent and he says, did God really say you would die if you ate of the tree of good and evil? So putting that down, is that what God really said? And with Jesus, he tries to put down Jesus' mind. He goes, if you are really the Son of God, as if Jesus didn't know who he was. But that's what he's trying to do. He's trying to create doubt. Just like he comes in our lives and tries to create that. Did God really say that by faith in his son, Jesus Christ, you would be forgiven? Did God really say through his son, Jesus Christ, that all those who believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Did Jesus really say that by his laying down his life for us, he's paying the debt of sin that you owe? All the while wanting you to question. What did God really say? What is the gospel message? And the sad thing is, we have seen Satan able to spin this down and sow this down into the life of the church when we look at its history. In the Middle Ages, the church began to feel like the gospel was too simple. That people needed to do more things to show they were a Christian, to show they really believed in the death of Jesus. That just simply grace by faith was not enough. And so they started demanding that people, to really be Christian, needed to go on pilgrimages. They needed to venerate relics, venerate the saints. They needed to pay indulgence for themselves and those loved ones who had already left this earth. See, all this is a way of supposedly protecting the gospel in its purity. The rabbis had done the same thing that Judaism centuries before. They had taken the simple covenant God had made with Moses and the Hebrew children of Sinai, and they kept putting fences around it, as my Old Testament professor called it. They put fences around the law. Those fences were known as oral law. And eventually, all these oral laws were collected in a book called the Mishnah. And the Mishnah is a book about this thick, close to 1,000 pages, with very tiny print. And it's just law after law, rule after rule, regulation after regulation that the devout Jew is supposed to follow in order to be following the law. So the Middle Ages church started doing the same type of thing, and then we had the Reformation. But unfortunately, the Reformation had spin off denominations that, as they developed the same attitude. As you all know, I was born and raised in Kentucky. Now, fortunately, that I grew up in Jefferson County, which is Louisville, and there were a lot of Lutheran churches in Louisville. A lot of Catholic churches, Episcopal churches, Methodist churches, Presbyterian churches, United Church of Christ, what we call mainline Christianity. But when we moved out on my grandmother's farm in Fairdale, I was surrounded then mostly by students who went to the Church of God, who went to the Non-Instrumental Church of Christ, who went to Southern Baptist Churches, Hardshell Baptist Churches, Forsberg Gospel Baptist Churches, Free Will Baptist Churches, Independent Baptist Churches, independent, more independent than their independent Baptist Churches, and on and on. And some of these denominations had rules that you had to follow to be a member of that congregation or a quote good Christian. So I had classmates who couldn't go to the movies, they couldn't go to the beach, they couldn't play cards, even Old Maid, they couldn't drink Coca-Cola, or Pepsi, or Dr. Pepper, or your other soft drinks, because they weren't quite sure there wasn't something funny in those drinks. They couldn't wear stylish clothing. The girls couldn't wear their gym suits that were prescribed for all the girls. And yet, here I'm looking at junior high school, where we had gym. There was a curtain that was pulled across at half court so that those guys on one side couldn't even see the girls on the other side. But girls who belonged to certain at least churches had to wear long skirts for PE, because to not do that was sinful. And that was needed, this type of action, besides believing in salvation by grace and faith. So that came from doubt, doubting Jesus. When he tells us that's how we're saved. And that's what the devil does. He goes about with his demons roaming the earth trying to create doubt to resist and destroy the church. So we must know who our opponent is. Second, we must know his tactics. His tactics is that of creating doubt, which I mentioned. Then he likes to appeal to human pride. He likes to appeal to you and say, now, why didn't you get that position? Why didn't you get that promotion? Why weren't you up there with the inner circle? So that's what he did with Judas. He came to old Judas. He said, Judas, how come you're not up there with Peter, James, and John? Why did those three always get to go off with Jesus? You got the purse. They trust you with the money. You've never been as good as Peter. Why can't you be the leader of the disciples? And so appealing to Judas' pride, Judas finally thought, yeah, why are they the boss? Why do I have to be under all these other Peter and James and John and never get included in the secret things that Jesus says to them? And so his pride got the best of him. And he sold Jesus out for 30 pieces of silver. Another of his tactics is he likes to attack us when we're vulnerable. Jesus had been fasting for 40 days and 40 nights. He was famished. So what better time to attack someone than when they're in a vulnerable position? Whether it is hunger, whether it is the loss of a loved one, whether it's the loss of a job, whether it's an illness, whether it is debilitating illness, whether it is some kind of other tragedy, that is when the devil loves to attack us. That's when we have to be open to the reality of that attack and be ready for it so it cannot be successful. We cannot let him create that doubt in our mind so that we wonder if Jesus is really with us. So we do not wonder if God really cares for us. But we know it and are assured of it through our faith. So we have to know those tactics and be ready to handle it. And as Jesus told Satan, when he attacked him when he was most vulnerable, he said, turn these loaves into bread. What did Jesus say? It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. It is written, it's described in writing. Who's writing? The writing of God. What are you to do? Obey every word that comes from his mouth, every utterance, every command of God. By doing that, we'll be ready for his times. He also said when he told him to jump down off the temple, he says, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test. That means you're not to tempt the Lord. You're not to try and make him prove himself. So I never can figure out that those Christian brothers and sisters in Eastern Kentucky and West Virginia and parts of Virginia and Carolinas insist on picking up rattlesnakes and cottonmouths and copperheads, daring the Lord to prove he's Lord by healing them when they get bit by one of those things. You know, we're not supposed to test the Lord. Again, that's the devil. It's tactic to create doubt. Oh, look at that. You got bit by that tumor rattler, now you're dying. What a shame. Ooh, if we don't put God to the test, we don't have to worry about that. So, we know our opponent. We know his tactics. The last thing we need to know, the third thing is, to know our weapon and how to use it. And that weapon is, as Jesus says, God's word. We combat Satan with God's word. We combat Satan with, for it is written. It is God's command. It is his utterance. It is his desire that is what we follow. If we know God's word and how to use it, then we can combat the devil and his temptation. But we have to know it. Because as we see in our gospel lesson today, even the devil can quote scripture. So just because somebody quotes scripture, it doesn't mean that they're telling the truth or that they're using that scripture correctly. see a lot of people who have made a living off of taking scripture and interpret it to their advantage to get you to give them your money. This old phrase of, give me your seed money. Give me some seed money. Give me $10. Give me $50. Give me $1,000. And I'll triple that for you. But you got to send it in, don't you? You know, just Ash Wednesday, where Jesus talking about not storing up treasures on earth, but to store treasures in heaven. And so we have to know God's word and how to use it. And as Jesus says, we're to worship only God. That word means to adore or to give homage to. He tells us we're only to serve God. That means to minister to God. That means to serve willingly. And it means to render religious homage. Only to God. And by doing that, we will know how to use his word and resist the devil's temptation. So there was a showdown in the desert between Jesus and Satan. And Jesus triumphed over Satan. And by his triumph showed us how we too can resist the devil when he comes to tempt us, no matter where we are or what we are doing. And that showdown in the desert was far more suspenseful and far greater than any showdown TV or the movies could ever come up with. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
Faithful ones who have traveled through the wilderness and now dwell in your paradise. Bring us with them to the eternal Easter feast of joy. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Hear our prayers, O merciful God, as we eagerly await the day of resurrection through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Now time for our offering. Our ushers are Nelson and Linda Smith. This is March the 5th, the first Sunday of Lent. We're meditating today on Jesus' temptation, 40 days and 40 nights. Lent is 40 days, not counting the Sundays. And during this time, we are to praise God, we're to worship, we're to study God's Word. The pillars of Lent are almsgiving and prayer and giving of ourselves, fasting, prayer, and almsgiving, the three pillars of Lent. We have Holy Communion today. It's the first Sunday of Lent, March the 5th, 2015. Our worship assistants, Becky Dimitroff, Connie Singleton was the reader, Nelson and Linda Smith are the ushers. We welcome you to come to the Wednesday services at 6:30, all during Lent. We're studying the words of our faith. We confessed our faith, we repent, we believe, we've made our confession. We love God, we love one another. We have Jesus in our hearts. We invite you, we're listening, watching this, to invite Jesus to come into your heart, to make him your personal Savior, to repent, to believe. We have the ushers coming forward now with the offering. We'll now go on for the communion service. We'll receive the true body and blood of Jesus Christ as he is here with us. He promised that he would never leave us, and he is here with us to share his body and blood in holy communion, most holy time of our lives as Christians. We are closest to Christ.
Holy, 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 holy.
hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your Son, Jesus, the Word made flesh. And the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is new covenant, my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Come, Lord Jesus. Holy God, we long for your Spirit. Come among us. Bless us, men. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, Power of the Most High, one God, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Bye. God has performed the miracle of the true body and blood of Jesus Christ. We received it. We believe the real presence as he promised that he would be with us forever. And he is with us now as we pray and we receive his body and blood. We don't know how the miracle happens that God is converting the bread and the wine. Jesus' true presence, but we do receive his true body and blood. We invite you to receive this as you are watching this on the YouTube today. Pray to God, and he will be with you. Jesus Christ, true body and blood.
Body of the Lord Jesus Christ, with his precious blood, strengthen and preserve you in true faith and the life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world, and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Conclude our celebration with singing Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross, hymn number 335, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 335.
This hymn was written by Fanny Crosby, 1869. She was a blind hymn writer who wrote 8,000 hymns, one of her most beloved hymns, Near the Cross. We're meditating on being near the cross with Jesus Christ who died on the cross to save us from sins. And we are praying, we're fasting, giving alms during Lent, 40 days, we're meditating on this hymn, Near the Cross, Fanny Crosby.